All right, we've already had 12 bouts this evening. It has all led up to this. Our main event of the night, it is the Featherweight Professional Championship of Chosen Few. As we take a look at the challenger, he is known as the Natural, Nick Compton. Compton, ranked number 5 in Minnesota, number 26 overall in the Midwest. Those rankings by Tapology. He is 35 years old and has naturally let his hair go gray here a little bit. You don't see a lot of snow on the top of the roofs of a lot of fighters in MMA, but you're seeing that tonight on the head of one Nick Compton, as you take a look at the Carbon World Health tail of the tape for our main event. That's our challenger. Now let's take a look at the champ, Alex Gilpin. All right, there is the strap that Alex Gilpin won, the professional featherweight title of Chosen Few. He won that back on January 14th, right here at the Monona Terrace. And here comes Alex Gilpin. He is all business and an exciting fighter to watch in the ring, as he brings his record of 7-1 into his first title defense here of that Chosen Few title. And Alex Gilpin looking ready for this one after a good 4-round battle that he won against Jose Pacheco back in January. There's the strap. It is on the line. We will have that as we get the introductions right now from Chris Garrity.
Ladies and gentlemen, this fight is brought to you by the Tin Factory, Razor Sharp and Carbon World Health, and sanctioned by the Department of Safety and Professional Services Program Director Adam Burkhalter, your cage side physician, Dr. Nestor Rodriguez, your judges, Gabriel Sabatis, Matt Janicek, and Larry Strzok, with timekeeper Micah Kappas. And ladies and gentlemen, the man in charge of this bout, veteran referee Tom DeBellis. And now, folks, the moment you've all been waiting for, this is your main event of the evening. Five rounds for the professional featherweight championship belt. Introducing first, this man fighting out of record, 12 victories, 6 defeats. 8 of his victories come by way of submission. He represents the Academy and hails from Minneapolis, Minnesota. Ladies and gentlemen, the challenger, Nicholas Compton. His opponent is this man, fighting record, 8 bouts, 7 victories, 3 knockouts. He stands in at 5'7" tall. He weighed 145 pounds. He represents the Chosen Few and hails from right here in Madison, Wisconsin. He is the reigning, the defending, the
a thunderous ovation for the champ, Alex Gilpin. All right, we are cage side here at the Monona Terrace along with Chris Garrity and the UFC's GM3, Gerald the Machine, Mearshart. I am Rich Reynolds, and here we go. The featherweight title on the line, 5 rounds scheduled here tonight between Gilpin and Compton. Compton has lost his last 2 fights. He's 35 years old. What can we expect from the well-traveled Nick Compton?
Well, Nick Compton's going to bring experience. He comes from an old school, one of the better gyms in Minneapolis, the Academy. Former UFC champions like Sean Sherk used to train there. So you're going to expect experience. You're going to expect calmness in the cage, no matter how much Alex Gilpin can show him. He's not going to show Nick anything he hasn't seen before. So that's what you're going to expect. Again, this is another one where Josh Steary went, hey, Alex has been running through people. He has a 7-1 pro record. I gotta find a guy with experience to test that title, and we're better than going to the Academy in Minneapolis.
And Gilpin, with a strong wrestling background, in fact, was a state of Texas champion back in high school, as he hailed originally from San Antonio, Texas, and he usually will apply a lot of wrestling technique. So far, we have seen Gilpin on his feet, and of course, as soon as I say he applies wrestling technique, he gets the single leg takedown.
The underused single leg takedown. Again, Rich, you don't see a lot of those in MMA like you used to, but you can tell great technique. The way he was able to sweep to the side like that is fantastic.
That's what wrestlers can do, man. They will shoot the leg, and now Gilpin looking to do a little ground and pound, and good defense by Compton to keep him at bay.
Yep, right now Gilpin looking to establish his top control. He's really doing his best to pin down Compton. Right now, Compton's got his legs open. Gilpin's trying to look to pass, but Compton doing a good job moving off his back, threatening sweeps, you know, threatening to throw Gilpin off balance and possibly go after a submission. Here looking for like a American sweep, or could possibly turn into Kimura. Gilpin pressuring down, landing a couple little body shots and trying to pass into half and possibly side control.
He's landing a lot of body shots right in a row, and Compton's just letting him at this point, and surprised that Compton wasn't doing anything to defend that. He finally has to get Gilpin to stop doing that, as he was just ripping into the side of Compton.
And the trouble Gilpin's going to have doing damage other than to the body is the length that Compton has. There's a 4-inch height difference. You can obviously see the reach difference, especially the torso, from the torso up when it comes to Compton. So for him to do any damage to the face, he had to do what he just did here. Pass into side control, hope, maybe even get his back here, because sitting in guard with a longer fighter like Compton, it's going to be hard to reach the face. He's going to use his hips and use his legs really well to keep you back, and you're not going to get much power.
Exactly, Chris. And as you just saw, for a brief second, Gilpin in half guard at least needs to get to half guard, land some elbows. You know, half guard's a good position where you can control the hips and still rain down some punches. But again, needs to pass those legs. At the very least, maybe stand up, land a couple big thundering shots, and try to pass off the punches like old school Fedor.
So with that decided height and reach advantage that Compton enjoys in this fight, how important is it for Gilpin to keep doing what he's doing, though, and that's staying right on top of Compton and getting in close?
If I could go first here, Gerald, what I actually, doing this in guard worries me more for an Alex Gilpin, because he's expending so much energy to either pass or strike that in a 5-round fight like this, I don't know how that's going to translate as the rounds go on here, because Compton's doing a great job really not sustaining any damage. And like Gerald had said earlier, his hips are moving so much that Gilpin also has to worry about being caught in a submission or anything else that's going to happen. So this is where we're really going to see what kind of gas tank Gilpin has, because you can't keep up this much energy trying to just pass someone's guard. He's done it almost the entire round. So how is this going to go from here forward?
That's a very good point, Chris. And as you said, you know, Alex has got to use his whole body and especially his arms to try to keep Compton in one place, whereas Compton can use more of his legs than his hips, even off the back. And as we've seen so far in this first round, Gilpin not really landing any damage to make Compton so concerned as to open up to really try and go for anything. And now we see Gilpin opening up a little bit and Compton almost getting his leg around one of Gilpin's arms, possibly set up a triangle. So now we see Gilpin posturing up. I think that's a better look for him. Posturing up, pressuring in with his hips and landing strikes just like that. But then after that, you have to use that advantage to pass.
Compton trying to use his length advantage to keep the real damage from being done. Gilpin continues to try to hit the face and the head of one Nick Compton. Gilpin on top, most of round number one. We're 5 minutes in to this championship defense for Alex Gilpin. Round number two next on 57 Sports. All right, we take a look at action from round number one, the single leg takedown from Alex Gilpin early on in the round, and from there, it was mostly Gilpin on top and Compton defending.
So yeah, he's gonna win this round just on sheer control and a bit of damage he did. Compton really never truly threatened Gilpin, but again, this is what I'm looking at right here. How hard is he breathing? What's gonna happen? Because again, this isn't your typical three-round fight that you see where he can just go balls out all three rounds. So he's gotta conserve energy somewhere. So if this fight ends up in that same position, I actually worry about Gilpin in the later rounds.
Gilpin won four rounds in his last fight to win the title against Jose Pacheco. We'll see if expending that energy and so much of it in round number one will have an effect. As again, Gilpin going right back to that same spot again, this time though trying to gain side control against Compton, and maybe that's the adjustment that he needed to make.
And it is. And let's go back to that fight with Jose Pacheco. The reason he was able to go four rounds and wear Pacheco down was because of all the damage he did to him doing this. But he hasn't done that damage to Compton. So, yeah, I don't want to keep beating a dead horse here, but he's got to stay inside control here. As Gerald recommended earlier, throw elbows, throw punches, do whatever he's got to do to really start wearing Compton down.
Yeah, looking much better here in the second round already. And, you know, he did another thing, which is very good. I saw Compton coming out with the Tiger Muay Thai all over his shorts and his shirt. You know, he's expecting to be able to throw all these kicks, I'm sure, in his head fighting a wrestler. Gilpin did a good job of actually catching that kick and using it as a takedown, which is going to make Compton think twice about throwing kicks at him, making it easier for Gilpin to get inside if Compton should find his way back to his feet. Now, in this position, if I was Gilpin and in his corner, I'd tell him to stay more in a traditional referee's position, just pressure him with the hips, land some good strikes, let Compton make a mistake, let him roll or roll him over like that, get in a dominant position, now try to get back to side and start landing some shots. Because that's the kind of thing you got to worry about from a long veteran like Compton. He just rolls right back over in the guard, and now we got to fight back to that dominant position.
And a beautiful escape from Compton. You couldn't have scripted that much better for the way he was able to get back to guard in that situation.
Yeah, Compton seems very adept at being able to defend on his back, get out of these tough situations that Gilpin is putting him in. And like you said, making Gilpin expend a lot of energy into round number two.
Now, what I do like better about this round, at least on the Gilpin front, is that you can tell Compton's had to work a lot harder. His mouth is open. He's breathing a bit. Gilpin has put Compton in trouble a few times, and now he's doing it again. So this is more of the game plan if you're in Gilpin's corner. You know, don't sit and guard. You need to be active. You need to put him in as much trouble as possible. And right now, all that length that Compton has doesn't mean a thing.
Exactly. And you know, as you said before, expending a lot of energy, even winning the round, but in a situation like this, where Gilpin's in a very dominant position and making Compton work, even though Gilpin might be spending a little more energy, just the mental side of, you know, winning so handily right now, seems like he's going for a north-south choke, don't know if he quite has the angle. The crowd sort of seems to be getting hyped up behind it, but I don't think that we're going to see a finish right here.
Now, I was going to say, he could have either neck cranked him right, or there could have been a blood choke the way he had his neck kind of, you know, dipped to the side on his forearm. But yeah, Compton did a good job getting out of that.
Yeah, the crowd thought we were going to see a submission there. Instead, Compton continues to work the good defense so far in this fight as Gilpin continues his assault, trying to go forward. Compton in defense mode, and that's what we have seen basically 90% of this fight so far.
And there's two, the reason I said blood choke is because there's really two types of chokes you can do with the neck. One that cuts off the air to your opponent, and the other that cuts off the blood flow to the opponent's brain, like hitting the carotid. So depending on the style of neck crank, the style of guillotine, the different style of submission you're looking at on the neck, there's a couple different ways guys can go out. When you go out from an air choke, you know it. That's why you see a lot of taps, a lot of submissions. When you go out from a blood choke, you are literally awake 1 second and asleep the next. You have no idea it's happening. And then you wake up with a screaming headache in about 10 seconds.
So. As we just saw in the previous fight with Alex.
Exactly, yep. You got it.
Now we see here Gilpin working to side control again. He's got his head under Compton's arm, looking to establish that. Compton doing a good job keeping his top knee just inside Gilpin's hip, giving him a way to make a little bit of space if he can, shrimp and recompose that guard. But Gilpin not having any of it, keeping good hip pressure. And here we see Compton finally shrimp and get back to guard.
But this is great for Alex. He did exactly what he needed to do, and this is keep moving. Now he's back inside control. Compton is now going to get, and now the less fresher of the two fighters because of how hard he's had to work in this round and how much trouble he's been in a few of these different types of either north-south submissions or neck crank style submissions. So Gilpin, this is perfect for him. If he could do this, the next three rounds, he's going to cruise.
Final 20 seconds of round number two. Alex Gilpin has been dominant here in round number two, and even after taking what we think was round number one, so the first two rounds going to the champion here as Compton continues to try to keep Gilpin off of him. We'll see how long he can continue to do that. We'll go to the third round next on 57 Sports. All right, fellas, at some point we're going to have to see some kind of offense from Nick Compton as we take a look at the highlights from round number two. Is that something Compton needs to do, or is he just waiting for Gilpin to make a mistake and get some kind of submission?
He hasn't been able to stay on his feet, so I don't know if you want to call it waiting for a mistake or just able to catch Gilpin, because every time Gilpin drives in for something, he takes him down. So, yeah, I guess you could say mistake might be what he's waiting for, but this, what Gilpin did in that second round goes to what Gerald was saying, smart movement. There's a difference between smart movement and energy wasting movement, and that entire second round was smart movement for Gilpin. He expended a lot less energy in the second round than he did in the first, but yet was more dominating.
Good stuff from Alex Gilpin in his first title defense against the well-traveled, well-seasoned Nick Compton, who comes in again 35 years old, lost his last two fights, but still a good ranking, and in fact highly ranked by Tapology, number 26 overall in the Midwest in a fairly stocked division, as once again, after some striking, we have about 30 seconds of that, and then we're right back to the ground.
And Gilpin knows exactly where he wants this fight, and the way he was able to dominate in the second round, there's no reason he needs to do anything else but this.
Exactly, and I really like what I'm seeing out of Gilpin now. He just did it and was doing it at the end of the second round. He'll kind of sit his head back, posture up real high, and drive his hips way in on Compton when he's in guard. Let Compton make the mistake, try to move his legs, and off that movement, he'll shuck his legs to the side, not just passing, but landing some strikes in between. So I really like that. It's making it very easy for him to get into side control and get this dominant position.
Working on the arm a little bit of Compton, we'll see. He doesn't be looking for the submission anymore. It's strictly control and position and a little bit of damage here and there. This is a dominating wrestling performance by Gilpin.
And that is what we have seen so far. I mean, it's been a one-sided match here as Gilpin looking for a way to finish off Compton. But like you said, he doesn't need necessarily to get the submission. He could just stay in control the rest of the fight.
Yeah, one thing I think he should start doing, he keeps going for the neck. He's doing a very good job controlling Compton on top, but maybe don't worry about going for the neck as much. Just get control and land some good, solid strikes. You know, soften your opponent up. Right now he's going for the north-south. Wow. Looks like he's got a pretty good bite on it, but I think, yep, Compton rolls out. He's just too far to the side. You need your opponent flat on their back for that to work, and you just couldn't get it.
And a great job from Compton to stay calm in that position. Like you said, roll. Because Gilpin is obviously an extremely strong fighter, so for him to stay calm in that position and get out was pretty impressive.
Crowd expecting a finish there. Compton continues to struggle his way on in this fight. Gilpin still on top and still dominant here as he had side control. Now he loses that once again, and we return to a familiar posture.
And right back into side, and that's what I was talking about. He needs to open up and see, lands those couple strikes. Compton tries his best to get recomposure, and then Gilpin's right there to bounce right back, giving him a reason to open up and make mistakes.
And rounds two and three here, when you're in a gym, and Gerald can attest to this more than anybody else here, and you're game planning for an opponent, this is what it looks like when you execute your game plan. And notice nothing coming out of the corner of Alex Gilpin right now, because they don't need to say anything. He's doing everything absolutely perfect to the game plan. His coaches are literally just enjoying
great
the
point.
Show.
They're yeah. just watching.
Just
they're silent.
The show.
Yeah. I mean, there's no instruction to give Gilpin at this point. He has been in complete control and working his game plan just as, like you said, how they planned it. And how often do you see that? It's rare in a fight that a guy is going to work the game plan from start to finish, but that's what Gilpin is doing here tonight.
And sometimes you'll see that in a fight that is mismatched, you know, or you got a guy, but then they usually, you know, dominate quickly and the fight's over. In this situation, it's not a mismatched fight. Compton is a game fighter and a good fighter, and you could tell because he hasn't really been close to being finished yet, but he's still being dominated, so.
Yeah, and to that, to like Gerald's point, what he was talking about, the difference between the pro and the amateur guys, the pro guys really know how to defend. They know how to keep themselves from getting or sustaining any real damage, and so Compton has been able to stay afloat in this fight.
Yeah, if you're in Compton's corner, you need to tell him he's got to do something now. I mean, he can't win the fight by decision. You know, no reason to wait till round five to start opening up. You might as well try to finish the fight now, because if it does go to a decision, you're going to lose.
Yeah, you're down easy, 3-0. The championship rounds are next. Gilpin doesn't look to be slowing down at all. So, Gerald, take me in the corner. Whether you are coaching or a fighter, what do you tell a guy down 3 dominant rounds with 2 left to go? He's obviously gassed. His maybe spirit has been slightly broken at this point. How do you get a fighter to come back?
You know, if I'm in this corner, I'm telling him straight up, hey, we're losing this fight. We're down 3. You need to finish. I don't care what happens. Either you get finished or you get a finish. It's time to go to work.
Absolutely. As Compton is just in this familiar position that he has been all night long, and that's in defensive mode, as it's been all Alex Gilpin in his first title defense. Round number 4. Will it be the one where Gilpin finishes Compton? We'll find out next on 57 Sports. As we check out the replay of round number 3, it looks a lot like rounds number 1 and 2. We've seen this before. This fight seems to be playing out in similar fashion every round for Alex Gilpin.
And it's a testament to Gilpin's corner. They saw the fight really wasn't going the way Gilpin ideally would want it in that first round. I know they sniffed out the fact that he was going to gas himself out. And they told him exactly what to do, and he's been following the game plan brilliantly. Total domination from Gilpin. But as Gerald said, you're in the corner of Compton right now. You've told him, we're in desperation mode right now. You are losing badly on all the scorecards. You got to come up with something nasty here.
And Gilpin was in danger of being the gassed out fighter right now as they start round number 4. Gilpin is obviously the fresher fighter of the two.
Yeah, he's actually been improving every single round. You know, the first round just kind of in guard, controlling. The second round, getting the side control a little bit more. And then in that third round, he was in side control almost the whole fight. Got his back with both hooks in to finish it off and was in mount for a little bit. Now an easy double leg, and we're right back to work for Alex Gilpin.
Yeah, he didn't even hide. Yeah, he didn't even hide that shot. He's not worried about the sprawl of Compton whatsoever.
Yeah, how easy that was. I mean, some of the easiest takedowns we've seen all night have been in this fight.
Yeah, already in side control, already back to posturing. He's going to look to go to mount. Looks like maybe get to that crucifix position again that he hit in the third round. So he's going to spread that forearm out. Now as Compton reaches for Gilpin's right wrist, he's going to try and step over that arm.
A lot of fights have been finished in the crucifix position, which isn't going to happen here just yet. Compton turning his back, which might not be the best idea either.
Yeah, I like Gilpin sitting back and going to this more referee's position, more of a wrestling position. But nice for him, he knows he's a wrestler. He's comfortable being on top. If you put the hooks in, you know, the guy can roll around. And even if you have their back, you know, a guy like Gilpin probably still more comfortable just letting Compton roll and ending up on top, back in guard or side control. And now he throws the hooks in.
Now he's got the hooks.
Now he's going to stay and right there, stay in mount, stay on top, let Compton roll and just make him work while he does the damage.
And again, you got to give some credit to Compton for the way he's been able to avoid damage and at least keep Gilpin a bit on his toes, but he can't win the fight defending the entire time. So, I don't see anything Compton can do at this point. And Gilpin, like you said, he's been improving every round. Yeah. His energy's gotten better. So,
absolutely.
This is a tough, tough fight for Compton.
And now here he is looking for that crucifix, steps over, and now briefly had him trapped. Compton did a good job rolling out, now getting to his feet. Gilpin using this lock. It's usually reversal or a choke. Now going for the choke, and he used it to throw him down for a takedown.
And that looks tight, Gerald.
Yeah, Compton is in trouble here in the fourth round.
That arm choke we got going.
And that is it. He taps out, and Alex Gilpin in control of this fight, especially from the second round on. He defends his title here tonight. In impressive style, especially using all of his wrestling background here this evening.
Well, he had set that choke up a few times, and finally Compton was too tired, didn't have enough to defend it. Gerald, the way he set it up on the feet like that, you don't see a whole lot, and then he twisted him to the ground. Explain how that choke works.
Yeah, so what he was doing, he had that locked up on the ground, kind of let Compton stand up. And as Compton stand up, he kind of started to cinch it in. He wanted to get Compton's arm and his shoulder jammed in his own neck and then use his forearm on the other side to create, as we were talking about, a blood choke. Cut off the blood supply to his head, and he actually used it as a takedown first, splash him back down to the ground where he could use his whole body to really get that squeeze in
and
there.
And a very cool name to that choke, too, which I know a friend of mine has used before.
That's right, the Anaconda
That's
choke.
That's right.
Nice.
Gerald won his last fight by Anaconda choke.
First, by UFC
or first
debut.
UFC fight, I'm sorry, by Anaconda choke. So wow. It was pretty impressive.
Love it, and I love going to school. You guys have been teaching me all night long. Great stuff. And speaking of going to school, Alex Gilpin schooled Nick Compton here tonight to defend his featherweight title. We will go to the cage for the official word from Chris Garrity. That's next here on 57 Sports. All right, we head up to the cage for the official announcement. Alex Gilpin defends his title.
Ladies and gentlemen, the end of this bout comes in 2 minutes, 17 seconds of round number 4 for your winner by Anaconda Choke and still the CFFC Featherweight Champion, Alex Gilpin.
He is the number one ranked fighter in the state of Wisconsin,
Alex,
and with good reason. Let's hear from him.
That first round, it seemed like you had a little bit of trouble passing his guard, and you maybe spent a little extra energy, but come round two, you were dominant all the way until you got that submission. Did that play out exactly the way you guys game planned it?
Hey, I'm ready to finish you 15 seconds, and I'm ready to fight 25 minutes. You know, he's really long, and he's good off his back. And sometimes it takes me a while to get going. And later rounds, I was passing guard, trying to ground and pound to control my posture, but I got it done.
Great fight tonight by Alex Gilpin, and what a way to put a cherry on top of a terrific card here tonight.